I'm crying.
Mykola Kuleba, CEO of Save Ukraine Rescue Fund. Just after the occupation of territories of Kherson and Kharkiv region, we recognize that it's a lot of children who've been abducted, who were deported, forcibly deported to the Russia or Crimea, and we plan how we can return them to Ukraine.
So, who's this for? Here. You crying too?
I can't believe I'm back home. Makes me want to cry.
When we return kids, we document this is war crimes, because every child is a witness of war crime.
The moment I left Russia, I felt very relieved.
Since their return to Ukraine 2 days ago, Liza and her friends have been staying a few kilometers outside of Kyiv. The exact location cannot be revealed for security reasons. Their families are still living in the south of the country, not far from the front line.
I'm angry at Russia because of all the Ukrainian children they kidnapped. We didn't want it. And some kids are still there. We can't get them back. And we don't know what's going to happen to them. They could be anywhere.
Save Ukraine is a Ukrainian NGO working to help bring deported children back home. It has a team of around 100 volunteers.
This department is responsible for the deported children we're trying to bring back to Ukraine. It's headed by Miroslava. She's a lawyer.
First, we get a phone call about a missing child, or we hear about it through social media, or our volunteers in the liberated territories. We then look into how the child disappeared and try to determine their current location. The parents or guardians often know very little about their child's whereabouts. That's why we try to find out more information and then handle the logistical side of bringing that child back.
The NGO's work begins as soon as a child disappears. But how do these children become separated from their families? How is Russia exploiting the chaos of war to abduct young Ukrainians? To find out more, we head to the south of the country. Russia had occupied part of this region for the best part of a year. In November 2022, they were ousted by Ukrainian forces.
We left Kherson after the liberation because the Russians were bombarding it. It's nice here. You have birds singing, the sun shining, and dogs barking. But I still want to go home.
Alessia Savinska has two daughters. Miroslava is 7 years old. Sofia is 15. She agrees to an interview, but doesn't want to show her face on camera. Her story began shortly after the invasion, when Russian forces captured the city of Kherson.
Sofia went to a Ukrainian school. Under the occupation, it was turned into a Russian school. But she still wanted to go, because it was her school.
The teachers offered to take us to a summer camp. At first they talked about how cool it would be, but then they insisted that we go. They said we could fake our parents' signature if they didn't want to sign. They said we'd be gone for 10 days.
On October 14, 2022, Sofia and her schoolmates were taken by bus and then boat to a holiday camp in the Russian town of Anapa. 10 days later, they were told they would not be returning to Ukraine.
We called the principal to ask when we'd be coming home, but he didn't answer the phone. We tried again and again for a whole 3 days, and he still didn't pick up. I was shocked. We all were. We realized that it had been a trap and that our situation was hopeless.
Sofia wrote to me on December the 20th that she wanted to come home. She said, "Come and get me now." I explained it wasn't that easy and started making inquiries, but getting her back was impossible.
The Russians then made an offer to Sofia and the 600 other young Ukrainians in her camp.
They said, if you want to go home, you need a Russian passport. Since you're 14, you don't have a Ukrainian one. You need a Russian one. What could I do? I had no choice.
It was all set up to return as few children as possible to their parents. No doubt about it. Sofia left Kherson on October the 14th and already had a Russian passport on the 25th. How can a passport be issued in just 10 days? On April the 9th, I headed for Kyiv, where another mother was waiting for me. From there, we got on a bus to Warsaw. And then some volunteers took us to Brest in Belarus. It was dark by the time we got to the border. The worst part was being interrogated in Belarus and Russia. They questioned me for more than an hour and a half, in the middle of the night. It was emotionally exhausting. They asked me where I wanted to go and why. The questions were really intimidating. Finally, I was able to catch a flight to Moscow. A car came to pick me up, and then we drove to Crimea. Another 3 hours later, I reached Sofia. And we went home straight away.
On April 8th, 2023, after 7 months in Russia, Sofia was reunited with her mother.
I didn't realize at first that I was leaving Russia. Right up to the last moment, I didn't think it would happen and couldn't believe I was back in Ukraine. I was desperate to come back home and was so happy.
I was so happy. Why are the Russians doing this? I guess they want to destroy our people. But from a human point of view, I don't understand how you can do these sorts of things. I just don't get it.
The Savinska family's story is a familiar one in the parts of Ukraine that came under Russian occupation. Thousands of Ukrainian children were brought to what were supposedly vacation camps.
The camps are part of a campaign of total Russification.
Daria Herasimchuk is an advisor on children's rights to the Ukrainian president. She says what's happening to Ukrainian children in Russian camps is a form of indoctrination.
They're not allowed to say they're Ukrainian, speak Ukrainian, or talk about their families. Instead, they're taught the Russian language, Russian culture, and history. Every day begins with the Russian national anthem. If a child refuses to stand up or sing, they're denied food or punished.
This video was shot 9 months into the war. It shows young Ukrainians from occupied territories being taken to a rather unusual holiday camp in Chechnya.
The young people here are given a patriotic, spiritual, and moral education.
In this camp in Crimea, Russian President Vladimir Putin himself gave an address to hundreds of teenagers, including young Ukrainians from occupied territories.
Hello, everyone. You're in Camp Artek, which is home for everyone who took part in our Great Change competition. We're now welcoming young people from all regions of our nation.
Vacation camps such as these are a legacy of the former Soviet Union. We were able to film one of these camps from a careful distance. A historian who wished to remain anonymous due to the harsh repression of critical voices in Russia explained the idea behind these camps.
We're in Leningrad region, in the village of Kaivitsa, near St. Petersburg. The summer camp on the other side of that fence was built in the Soviet era. Parents would send their children on vacation here and pay next to nothing. Parents could receive vouchers at work in order to send their children to these camps.
She says there are still more than 3,000 camps like this across Russia. Ukrainian children end up sent as far away as Siberia.
The camps had a military-style routine, and still do. I compared the daily schedules. In terms of form and structure, the system set up in the 1920s hasn't changed. Nothing has changed.
Kherson, in southern Ukraine, was occupied by Russian forces for almost 9 months. Since its liberation by Ukrainian forces, it's continued to come under relentless bombardment. As part of a program of Russification, Moscow even abducted Ukrainian children from local orphanages.
When the war began, there were 52 children between the age of 3 and 18 living here.
Volodymyr Sakhaidak is the director of a rehabilitation center for children in Kherson.
Most of the children's rooms are on the first floor. This one is for teenagers. Four boys lived here. This is our tree of joy with photos of the 52 children who lived here during the occupation.
Stories about children being deported spread like wildfire through the occupied areas. Volodymyr had also heard the rumors before the Russians arrived at his orphanage.
I thought, if I don't hide the kids or we're not evacuated, then the same thing's going to happen here. They'll end up in Russia. When it became clear that we weren't going to be evacuated and were on our own, I started thinking about how to hide the kids. We hid 17 kids in the homes of staff members, teachers, nurses, and social workers. To be on the safe side, we invented fake background stories for them. In the end, 5 teenagers were left. When the Russians arrived on June 4th, they were with me.
The Russians' arrival was filmed in secret.
On the video, you can see the door opening.
The footage came from the center's surveillance cameras.
The security guard lets in 2 FSB officers and 2 soldiers.
2 masked and armed soldiers demand to be shown around the orphanage. They want to know where the children are. One of the FSB officers is seen checking the orphanage's records. But he doesn't find what he's looking for. Volodymyr and the 5 teenagers say nothing.
These kids are real patriots. They didn't want to talk to the Russians. They just said they were fine and didn't need anything. And they refused to have their photos taken.
The Russians didn't take the teens with them, apparently because there were too few of them. A few kilometers away, the Russians continued their search in the maternity clinic and the children's hospital. Here, too, the children were saved thanks to the courage of staff members.
These windows look out onto the Dnieper River. The Russians shot at us from the other side. A missile landed here on New Year's Eve. We piled up sandbags against the windows.
This baby was born in the 30th week and had a serious pneumonia. We were caring for the baby. All the maternity clinics were attacked by missiles, every single one. Soldiers entered the hospital, pretending to be doctors. Unfortunately, our head physician gave them a warm welcome. They told us to hand over a list of the children so they could be evacuated. But we knew what that would mean. So we changed the children's medical records to make them appear sicker than they were. We set up a fake intensive care unit, complete with monitors, electrocardiograph machines, and all the other equipment. We issued reports twice daily that said the children were too sick to be transferred.
Every day at the start of my shift, my colleagues would tell me in the handover that the children in serious condition were too sick to be transferred. If our boss had stopped by, he'd have seen through it immediately, but fortunately he didn't come by. These are the rooms where we put the supposedly sick children. The entire team fought to keep them from being taken to Russia, Crimea, or even further away. Our strategy was a joint effort.
No one broke ranks, and the Russians didn't manage to deport any of the children. Eventually, Kherson was liberated by the Ukrainian army.
We were so happy to see the Russians leave. We were a bit scared at first, and then just relieved they were gone.
Meanwhile, Many Ukrainians risked everything to hide children. And for Russia, keeping children in vacation camps was just the first step. The Russification program organized by Moscow went well beyond that. Ivan Mutkovsky and Maxim Boyko managed to escape. They came very close to never seeing Ukraine again. Maxim is an orphan. Ivan's mother lost custody of him. The two teenagers now live in an orphanage.
We don't like this guy, which is why we put this on the door, so that everyone knows what we think. Ukraine will win.
The two boys' story began in Mariupol, 1 month after the war started. They shot this video on March 20th, 2022, on the morning after a night of bombardment.
On March 20th, we set out for Manhush on foot. We passed what used to be a Ukrainian checkpoint, but was now a Russian one. From there, we were taken to the hospital. The head nurse heard that we were orphans, and because Manhush was now occupied, they called the social welfare office in Donetsk. The next morning, people arrived to pick us up.
The boys were subjected to Russian propaganda from the day of their abduction. With a camera running, the pro-Russian mayor claimed to be their rescuer, even wearing a medical smock for greater credibility.
You listening to the doctors? And taking your medicine?
Yes.
Then you'll be doing better soon. Thank God you got out of there alive. The war is now over for you. You're home. And you'll grow up in a caring and safe environment. You'll be in good hands. You can get back to your daily lives, including school. We'll take care of everything.
We didn't expect that. We still hadn't been able to recover from Mariupol, and we're kind of half asleep. I couldn't sleep properly, and then he comes along promising all this stuff.
They said we could go to high school in just 1 week's time, and promised we'd be in a really nice orphanage. But we stayed in the hospital. Nothing happened.
They interrogated us twice, because our conversations were suspicious. There were a lot of children from Mariupol sent with us to Donetsk who'd been separated from their parents, where their parents no longer had custody.
Ivan and Maxim have their teacher, Anton Viktorovich, to thank for their return to Ukraine.
Take a seat.
3 months after their arrival in Donetsk, he picked them up from occupied territory, just in time.
Thank God they weren't taken to Russia. All the other children were promised that they would return, but none of them did. Philip was in that group too. Maria Lvova-Belova adopted him and even boasted about giving him a phone for his birthday. So heroic. God forgive me, but I wish she were dead.
This is Maria Lvova-Belova with the boy she forcibly adopted, Philip. And this is her on February 16th, 2023, talking to Vladimir Putin.
I've been visiting hospitals in particular regions that are treating children injured by explosions. It's shocking to hear, but they say they were shot in the back by Ukrainian soldiers, especially in Mariupol.
Maria Lvova-Belova is Russia's presidential commissioner for children's rights, personally appointed by Vladimir Putin.
This is for you.
Since the beginning of the war, she's made repeated public appearances in occupied areas, posing on camera at the bedside of Ukrainian children.
What's it for?
It will help me get better.
Lvova Belova encourages Russian families to adopt children deported from Ukraine. This is the final phase in the program of Russification, coordinated together with Vladimir Putin.
We've compiled a list of children who already have the required documentation, meaning Russian citizenship.
Why not the ones who aren't Russian?
There are administrative rules that we have to respect.
Tell me which ones you mean and we'll get around them. Right now, we have to prioritize the children's interests over bureaucracy.
2 months after that conversation, Putin signed a decree making it easier for Russian families to adopt Ukrainian children. The Russian propaganda machine immediately swung into action, with documentaries like this one apparently showing Ukrainian children living happy lives after their forced adoption by Russians.
This is my nice big family, my dad and my beloved mom.
The International Criminal Court in The Hague accused Maria Lvova-Belova and Vladimir Putin of war crimes and issued arrest warrants for overseeing the abduction and deportation of children.
The Russian media, of course, say the kidnapped Ukrainian children were evacuated as a noble act of kindness for their own good. But that's all nonsense. All the decisions made by the Russian authorities to make it easier to change children's nationality and adopt them prove that they never had any intention of returning the children. This is not an evacuation. According to our figures, Russia abducted 200,000 to 300,000 Ukrainian children. We have specific evidence of the deportation of some 19,400 children, but so far we've only managed to bring 366 of them back home.
Philip still lives with the woman who adopted him, Maria Lvova-Belova. Ivan, who survived the assault on Mariupol, has been in touch with him.
I write to him regularly. He tells me how he's doing. I ask how they're treating him. He seems to be okay, but he doesn't like that the woman works for that guy, Putin. He's staying upbeat and is still pro-Ukraine.
As the war continues, Ukraine is determined to liberate other areas from occupation. And many believe that children there have also been deported.